Hey there, everybody. Welcome. It's Monday. We are drawing together. I'm Scott with Artist Network. It looks like many of you have already joined, are getting ready to go. Some questions about the materials. I'm seeing a bunch coming up. Today, I'm actually going to be working with an ebony pencil, equivalent to like a 6B or so, 6B or 8B soft graphite pencil. So if that's what you've got, great. There was this other question that was from Mary Jo. You have a question about whether you should use a 2B pencil or a go into the charcoal. And what I can offer you is kind of to explain why I chose the ebony pencil for this one. And really, it's because I want to be focusing kind of on proportions. I'm challenging myself in that way more than really focusing on the light and shadow. Now, this reference photo will be... I adjusted it so that you have a strong contrast between light and shadow there. And so I think it would lend itself very nicely to charcoal. You can see here in this preliminary one that I've done that it doesn't quite get as dark or as rich as what we might see in that reference. So I think for you to kind of decide whether you want to kind of focus on the light or whether you want to really kind of focus on kind of proportions and kind of control. And that's really what if you choose either one, you're going to be able to kind of achieve that. So this with graphite, I still incorporate light and shadow in here. It just doesn't give me that full range of the charcoal does. But I really liked that this ebony pencil allowed me to get into the details a little bit more than I was feeling like the charcoal. So it was really kind of a toss-up for me, but in the end, I think I decided to lean towards ebony. So if that makes sense. We see some other questions here. Class on urban landscapes from Isabel. I think that would be a fantastic one. I do have a couple references that I've been looking at for future episodes, so check that out. Another thing that I want to call out as well is that I will be doing a live drawing tomorrow at noon Eastern. That's going to be on our Facebook feed there. So check out Facebook Live at around noon Eastern time, and check out the Artist Network Facebook feed there. So if you haven't already subscribed there, check that out. So I'm going to try that then, and then on Wednesday I'm going back to YouTube. So I'll be doing today's drawing as well as Wednesdays at 3 p.m. Eastern on YouTube, Tuesday at noon on the Facebook channel. So let's see. I'm going to dig right into it. While I have this up, we'll talk about the preliminary one. Now, this was incredibly frustrating, and I'm hoping I can kind of go through this journey with you all. And as if you've seen my self-portrait course or drawing, it was a struggle. I tend to struggle with figures and portraits because I just don't spend as much time with them. I am primarily a landscape painter. When I do kind of deviate from landscape, I tend to go towards still life. That tends to be in my comfort zone. This gets to be a challenge, and that's what I'm trying to embrace here. So I'm hoping that throughout this process, you're kind with yourself. So as you're following along, if it's not working out, it's struggling for me as well. So I look at this and I see lots of little things that are wrong. In terms of really capturing the likeness. And that's what's so challenging with portraits is that we have kind of two things that we're balancing. It's somewhat easy to create a portrait that looks like somebody. It gets really challenging, for me at least, to create a portrait that looks like a specific person. And that's what I feel like it happened here, is I feel like I created a portrait that looks like a person, but when I carry it over to the reference photo, it doesn't feel like the same person, and I don't know exactly why. I kept checking the proportions. I felt like they were right, but in very subtle ways, things can deviate in the drawing that makes it very challenging, or kind of opens the door for it to feel like it's somebody else. So getting things right is really kind of essential for capturing that likeness. And so the great portrait artists, they can do that. They latch onto really what is essential and they get that right. And then they allow everything else to kind of fall in place. So hopefully that makes sense, and we'll kind of walk through that process a bit more. So this is where we're heading today. Hopefully something that has even a stronger likeness to this person here. I found this on Pixabay. It's a free site for reference images, and they're all available for commercial use and without any sort of licensing there. Before I dig in, I see a couple of questions here. All right, yeah, Mary Jo, I think working on graphite is a perfect way to go. And I think it's really healthy to kind of shift and, bounce around between materials every so often. So maybe do a few drawings in graphite, a few drawings in charcoal, and kind of learn from one one and the other and balance that out that way. So, all right, we're going to dig right into it. As you can see, I toned the paper. You can see my my pencil here has been shaved away. I do this so often in my drawings so that I'm exposing that core. And that gives me a nice broad surface with which I can kind of fill in this area. This is going to be a little bit longer. I'm anticipating this is going to take a little bit longer than some other drawings, so I wanted to get a jump start. So I've toned this paper, giving it a slight gradient from left to right. I've zoomed in a little bit so that we're kind of cropping off some of the page. This is an about 11 and a half by 16 inch piece of paper. If you have an 11 by 14, that's probably going to work as well. Like I said, I just kind of have this bigger surface. Hopefully we're not losing any or cropping off too much of the drawing, but you can kind of see that my main goal in this initial kind of pass was just to get a tone on the page, and I'm prioritizing a kind of a slightly darker value on this side because the light's coming in from this angle. This side is going to be in light, so we have a stronger contrast there. If I lighten this, this will be against a darker shadow. So we're going to have a nice balance between light, dark, and light and dark. So, and then what you can see is, hopefully you can see on this is in graphite, it's all very light. I've started to just kind of lay in some basic proportions, establishing kind of a central axis here. And what's really important for me at this stage is to remind myself that that is not fixed at this point. This is an orientation point, and I need to be open to allowing that to fluctuate and move as I adjust things. But it just gives me a basic starting point. Then I establish a horizon or a horizontal line here to help place the eyes. This is perpendicular to this vertical central axis. A little bit lower than midway, because in the reference photo, if you measure this out, the eyes are a little bit below halfway. So there's, you know, we have a bunch of the hair kind of sticking up that it kind of adjusts the overall proportions. I wanted to make sure that I have enough room on the top to allow for all of that. So I dropped that, the center line of the eyes down a little bit, a rough central axis, and then a rough line for the bottom of the nose is going to be kind of somewhere in this area. The mouth is going to be somewhere in this area. And for now I have something that I can start to work with. I can start to do some angle sighting to establish the jawline. So if I find the general angle for that jaw, I can carry that across and start to drop in lines there. Lines for the cheekbones. I can take this angle here. And as you can see, I'm treating these angles, like the jawline and the cheekbones, as short, straight sections rather than one continuous curve. And I'm just getting information on the page. This may not be correct, and I'm assuming it's not correct. I just need something on there so then I can make an official judgment. Does it need to go up or down, left, right, bigger, smaller? But I want to start to react to the general shapes that I'm seeing. And just giving myself some orientation points. So if I've got a line that represents the bottom of the nose, this line in here, I'm keeping it intentionally vague. I want this to be a fuzzy line so that I don't lock myself into something too quickly. And then I'm taking my horizontal line here for the eyes, and I need to start to segment that into the shape of the eyes. And in general, there are some general kind of proportions that can be helpful in that. That generally the eyes are one eye width apart. So if I place the eye in here, between these two marks here, and I establish these marks that represent the corners of the eyes, then the space between them should be generally equivalent. And that's generally a good place to start. And then you want to look critically at the reference photo or at the sitter if you're working from life and adjust from there. Because everybody is slightly different. Some people's eyes are a little bit wider apart or closer together, etc. Then generally the nose falls between the eyes. So if we've divided this line up here into three equal segments, then the nose generally falls in the space between the eyes. She's got a slight turn to her head, and so there it might, that's going to shift things a little bit. The nose might come over just a touch. So I need to, I'm gonna keep these lines a little bit fuzzy now, so I know that the nose is gonna be somewhere in this area. And then the mouth is generally a little bit wider than the nose. And again, this is where everybody's proportions vary. And so I wanna start to just kind of rough in some of these shapes. Another thing, once I've gotten this established here, what I like to do is I like to do some angle sighting and align the corner of the nose or the nostril there with the corner of the eye. So what if I'm looking at down here, I'm taking a measurement, an angle from that the right side of the nostril to that right corner of the eye to get an angle. And I feel like that's generally pretty close. I can do that over here. And in this case, because her head is just very slightly turned, these angles are going to be slightly different. If she was looking directly on at us, those would be generally, you know, it'd be much more of an equilateral triangle. But she's turning just slightly because I can see a bit more on this side of her cheekbone, a bit less over here. Also, just looking at the shape of the nose, if I look at those nostrils, I can see that this nostril aligns just a little bit to the right of that corner of the eye. This nostril aligns just to the right of this corner of this eye. So it should suggest that there's a slight turn there. And I'm not at the point where I can really represent that. I'm making these mental notes so that I don't find myself forcing a symmetry into this portrait that doesn't really exist. And that may have been what I did in that first one, why it doesn't quite work out. So at this point, I've just kind of blocked in some basic proportions. I want to, let's see, maybe suggest the eyebrows so I get a sense for their volume. And then measuring kind of up to the hairline. And I want to be careful not to establish this as a line too much. You can see I had an initial line there, but this is really kind of a region. You know, it's a very soft transition area. And so what I'd like to do, and what I did in that first portrait, was allow most of the portrait to be loose and sketchy, and then bring focus in right on the eyes, the nose, and the mouth, and add that detail there. So now that I have some basic proportions, maybe I'll get a line for the neck. And so I'm just kind of looking at, I'm looking at the jawline here that I'm establishing, looking at the reference and determining where along that edge it intersects that neck. And then I also can see, does that align generally with what I'm thinking about for the placement of the eyes? If I carry a plumb line up from that intersection point, where does that align with the eye? And I may have to come over a little bit. So again, I don't know exactly, it's gonna be somewhere in this area. So again, I'm giving myself kind of a soft line there that I can move around. So hopefully this is all making sense. Now, what did I do that first one? I'm trying to remember. I think at this stage is where I really wanted to start to block in. I wanted to start blocking in some light and shadow before I get too lost. And so this is where I squint at the reference. So I eliminate the detail, and I try to see the larger shapes of light and shadow. And this is where it's helpful to have that paper toned a bit. I feel like it accepts the layer of shading on top of it a little bit easier and allows me to kind of sneak up on the values a little bit more. Now this hair is going to be in shadow a bit more, and then this eye is in shadow as well. And what is helpful at this point, and the reason why I like to start to do this at this stage, is that I start to interpret what's happening on the drawing as a three-dimensional form, as a mass versus a kind of two-dimensional flat linear shape. Because it's possible that I have all of these lines correct, but it doesn't feel right because I don't see it as a three-dimensional object. And so I need to start to make it feel like a three-dimensional form a bit more. So then I can evaluate those proportions a little bit more effectively. If that makes sense. And let's see, one of the things that is also helpful, and you'll have heard me say this in other of these drawings as well is establishing kind of anchor points that you're using to evaluate your proportions with. So at some point I need to lock proportions down, and then whenever I make a statement about where something belongs, I'm going to use those locked down proportions as a reference. So what I mean by that is, let me see, maybe what I'll do is I'll actually start to lock down the eyes, and I want to, I kind of have this rough central axis here. I'm going to start to work my way on either side of that that central axis, looking for the general shapes, and to keep working back and forth. Actually, what I might do is bring this down here. One of the challenging things here is that I'm looking down at this at an angle. If I was working vertically, that would be preferable. So if you have that option, I would suggest that you take it. I think it becomes more effective in terms of evaluating those proportions. Now at this stage, I'm trying to kind of ignore the fact that I'm looking at eyes and a nose and a mouth, and that there's this specific person here in the reference. I'm trying to think about it as an abstract form. I'm just looking at shapes of light and dark. And if you've been watching this series, this is generally the approach I take with a lot of drawings, which is to allow that drawing to emerge on the page. And thinking very generally, gradually becoming more specific as we go. And having worked with various portrait artists. We recently filmed a portrait video with Nathaniel Skousen, who's a professional portrait artist. He's a signature member in the Portrait Society. I picked up a lot of good pointers from him. And I've tried incorporating them, but they just didn't, some of them I just need more practice at. You can tell he's been doing it a lot longer than I have. I'm kind of relying a bit on my own comfort at this stage, what I'm comfortable doing, and I'm also thinking in the back of my head, what would Nathaniel be doing? In general, he likes to build from a three-dimensional form as well, and then gradually add the details. And for him, it's all about building. Building form so that it feels like a unified head. So what I really need to struggle with, or what I need to overcome, is this desire to treat the eyes, the nose, and the mouth as separate entities. It's the whole forest and tree situation, where we have to think about the whole head. The eyes and nose and the mouth are just features that are built onto it as one structure. But it's so easier for us to lock onto each one of them individually and think about them as individual features. But then if we're not careful, we end up with kind of like a Mr. Potato Head look, where it, they're just almost like a mask where things are kind of pasted on there. So that's what I'm trying to do, is trying to let the form build the features out of there. So I'm looking at the shapes kind of in this triangular area. And I think what I need to do is now I need to start to... I keep coming back down to the nose. So what's happening is that I want to place the eyes, but I keep finding that in order to place them correctly, I need them to line with the nose as well. And so then I'm kind of jumping back and forth between the nose and the mouth. I mean, the nose and the eyes. So then if I establish this kind of nostril over here, carry a line up, I know that the corner of the eye is pretty much in line with that, a little bit to the left. And then I can start to draw the shape of the eye in there. And as you can see, I'm utilizing the side of the pencil. I really don't want to engage the point of the pencil at this point, because it's gonna create a mark that's too intense. I think this is all looking very dark, so I'm gonna lighten this up a little bit. That's too much. All right, let's see if that works. If this is going to be difficult for viewing at this point. So if you're joining us a little bit late, we're working on the portrait of this girl here. It's all very light, and so if it looks out of focus, it is, in the way that, you know, the drawing is not sharply rendered at this point. So we're trying to allow this to kind of emerge on the page. So I think that might be a little bit better. Okay. So I'm just kind of blocking in some of the basic shapes. So when I'm working on the eye, I'm trying to think about the structure around the eye. And I'm going to keep coming back to that nostril right there, using that to create this kind of triangle right in here. I'm not thinking about the specific shape of the eye. I'm trying to think about it generally. It creates this specific triangle in there. I want to think symmetrically across here. And one of the ways I like to think about when I'm working with the side of the pencil, I'm floating it up on top of the paper and then just gradually lowering it down. And as you can see, like I'm not working with any very particular specific lines at this stage. I want to get in there and talk about the structure of the eye a little bit as I kind of evaluate this and see if this is working out okay. I think it's going to work out okay. See, I'm in the, at least in the ballpark in terms of the basic proportions. And then I can gradually correct this jawline. It's just this jawline over here is really where I struggle. And I think it's important to take note of where you find yourself being consistently off, because then you can start to do something about it. I don't know where that mouth should go. But I'm feeling confident that that general area is okay. All right. I'm just going to bring up a little bit more value in here. I think what I'm going to do is, let's see, if I reestablish my primary points for the eyes, I can take a look at that distance between them. And maybe I think it does need to come over a little bit more. So again, in this reference photo, they're generally an eye width apart, the eyes are. So this is going to be a kind of a slowly emerging image. I forgot to mention that you'll find the reference photo in the description below the video, so check that out. You can bring that up if you'd like and follow along with. If you are new to this series, you'll want to know that you can re-watch this video as many times as you'd like. So if you just like to sit back and watch right now, it's perfectly fine. A lot of people do that, and then they take a stab at the drawing later on. And this is, I want to be kind of clear that this is an exercise. You know, this is all. I'm here to exercise my drawing muscles. This isn't an opportunity for me to say this is how drawing should be done, because you're going to find a way that works for you specifically. But I just want to take this opportunity to practice my own drawing, improve my skills, and kind of share that experience. And hopefully, you all will share that as well, and that you'll find your own kind of path through the drawing process. We've seen quite a few of you sharing your drawings on artistnetwork.com. You'll find a link in the description where you can go to the Drawing Together page, and that links further into the individual show pages for the series, where I've seen a lot of you been posting the drawings that you've been completing as we go along. I've lost track what episode we're on, or episode 32 or 33 then, something like that. So let's see the so like I said, hopefully this is just an opportunity for us to kind of share our processes together rather than identify kind of one correct way of drawing or incorrect way of drawing, just what serves you is really what we're here to get. And I hopefully encourage you all to challenge yourselves with subjects that are subjects and processes that you're kind of less comfortable with, because that's the best way to improve your drawing skills. Got to stretch those muscles. So I'm looking at that eye. It looks enormous. One thing I like to do is just kind of wipe this all down. All right. I think also shading stump. I've been using this quite a bit throughout this whole drawing series. And I'm going to pull this out right now and utilize this as an opportunity to kind of block in some of those shadows and just kind of moving the graphite around. When I squint at the reference, I lose the differentiation in this area, so I want my drawing to kind of reflect that as well. So there's this really interesting shape where that upper eye socket is in shadow more, especially it kind of prioritizes the outer edge over here. Get a little bit of light catching in here under the under lower eyelid, and this is really a spherical form, so it's catching some bounce light in there, and then we pick up the shadow in here. So I'm just kind of starting to refine some of that, those forms there with a shading stump. And one of the things that I like to do too is what you can see I'm doing here is I'm unifying the brow. There's kind of, in general, across the bridge of the nose and the brow, there's kind of this one rounded form, and then the eyebrows kind of cross and wrap around over that. And what I often see students do is so focus so much on the eyebrows that then we lose the structure of the bone and the brow underneath it. And of course, everybody's face is slightly different, and so it may not, you know, be, you know, relevant to, you know, if you're not working on from this specific image, or if you're working on a different portrait, it may not be quite as relevant to you, but just look for that general shape across here. And then we see this light here, that turn in the nose. I want to think about the plane here in the nose here. Under here we have, again, the spherical form of the eye socket. This is a very light touch that I'm utilizing here. And then with the bridge of the nose, we see an angled plane down this way. We see the pad of the cheeks here, and then it gets a little bit harder in here in the eye socket. And so I want to look for those structures there. One of the other things that I like to recommend to students as well is to be continually thinking about the space between the features. It's so easy to fall into trying to see the eyes and nose and the mouth and see those shapes. But we need to connect those all together by looking at the structure of everything around those features. And so I'm trying to remind myself that as well. So kind of just gradually adding another layer of specificity to these forms here. And I feel like this starts to become a little bit easier to see. I'm moving my eyes very quickly back and forth between the reference photo and the drawing. This is where I often fall apart as well. I often make that upper lip too big. So I'm trying to be conscious of that. And I know that of myself because I've done enough of these drawings. And that's where I always correct. I always get that wrong. And so every time I do it, I do my best to counteract it. But I find there's almost like this muscle memory that's working in to the process where I just keep repeating that. So as I'm going through, one of the things I'm doing is I'm looking at the reference photo. I'm thinking about the path. And I'm looking at kind of in the periphery of my vision at what this hand is doing. And at the same time, I'm also quickly checking in where it is relative to other features. So as I'm coming down along here, I'm starting to define the cheekbone, and I'm looking at this kind of curve in here, but I need to come across and see how does that relate to the nose, and is that generally close to where we need it to be. I'm coming down here now towards that jawline, now, and then carrying it across, looking here, is that generally close to where it needs to be for the in relation to the mouth. And then as I come across here, this is a really tricky jawline here, looking at that turn relative to the mouth, but I'm also kind of checking in with some of the other features, and I want to keep these marks really light and loose. And I'm trying not to get bogged down in one particular area, because here's what I've done far too many times. It's like I've got to this stage and then I jump in and I finish an eye. And I move to the next eye and I finish that. And then I move to the rest of the face and I'm feeling like I'm all done. And then I look at it and the eyes are out of alignment. I tend to have this eye over here kind of migrate up. Or I'll get locked into the mouth or something, and I'll get to this point where I'm feeling more confident than I should in terms of where things are placed. And so I'm out of that experience, I'm trying my best to not lock down anything in particular at this stage. I'm still just kind of zeroing in on some forms. So with the nose here, there is a particular kind of W shape that I'm looking at, but it's also, there's a general shadow shape here, and I think it's more critical for me to get that shadow shape than the specific shape of the nose. So I want to get that in there. And I'm feeling pretty good about these proportions right now, so continuing to double check. You can see as I come up here to the hairline, I'm just kind of keeping it kind of loose and sketchy, not spending a whole lot of time there. Part of what I'm doing at that point is I'm just clearing my mind a little bit. It's so easy to become fatigued by focusing on one particular area. And so this allows me to... it allows me just to kind of clear my head a little bit. So I'm going to talk a bit about the structure of the features as we go. Again, I'm just kind of reacting to the shapes of the shadows as I see them. You can see I'm not being precious with the edge of the head or any of the features. She feels like she's right now, I'm viewing her underwater through foggy glass. And one of the things here, what I'm looking at right here is like around on the temple area, there's generally the forehead, which has got a slight curve, but it's generally a plane across here. And then we turn back along the side of the head back towards the ears. So the ears and the eyes on the page are only an inch apart, but on the person, they're 4 to 6 inches of space between them. So how do I represent that? And what I want to do is look very carefully at the structure here. So as we go around the eye socket, as we come around here, that merges with the temple, and that becomes where the plane changes to the forehead. And so then we have the generally flat plane here, the forehead, but if you break that down even farther, you can generally break it into thirds where there's a slight angle to the forehead here, it flattens out here, and it angles here, and then really turns as we come across back in here. So that's what I'm trying to observe. There's not a lot of information, it's all very subtle. So I want to do what I can to see what's in there, but I know that that's going to be really critical in terms of creating a three-dimensional head, pushing those ears back. If you look at the masters like Rembrandt, he was particularly adept at creating that depth in that space. I'm now doing a little bit of negative drawing. I'm going to soften that up a little bit. It's got a very slender neck, so I want to make sure that I'm getting that correctly. And if I squint my eyes, the shadow under the neck, on the neck, under the chin, kind of merges with the shadow of the chin. One of the things I did in the first one was I finished the head and then I added the neck, and I had a hard time really merging the two. So I want to start with the idea of them being merged more. Getting that shadow in there. Okay. Starting to come together here, and I think we can... what's difficult in the reference photo is this so light in value over here that I need to really work that You really need to work that edge. It feels so heavy right now. So if it looks like I'm scowling at you, I'm squinting at the screen where I see the projection in front of me of what I'm drawing. That simulates looking or stepping back from the drawing. It helps me to essentially set it up and walk across the room to see how those proportions are coming together. So I think for the sake of this drawing, I think I need to be okay with the idea that this is generally going to look like a person, but there's a good chance it's not going to look like this person. It's going to be close, and you're like, that kind of looks like your sister. But I feel like that's where it's coming, because I could really spend all day continuing to refine this, and I'm not sure as if it's going to give you a significant amount of information beyond that. So I'm going to carry across the ears, kind of suggesting the earlobes in here. So what I'm doing is I'm relating the earlobes to the nose. So generally the ears sit between the nose and the eyes. She's got a slight downturn to her head, which brings the ears up. And so that's why it's not perfectly symmetrical and not perfectly centered in the ears there. Okay. This is the other. So in here, when we see the brow, it gets dark in here underneath the brow. It catches the light here a bit more, and then the center of the forehead generally kind of catches a little bit of shadow in there, and then we get the light that strikes at that turn on the forehead right at the hairline. So again, generally the eyes fall in the middle of the head. She's got a slight downturn, so that pushes the eyes down just a little bit. One of the proportions that I determined was helpful is to check this. So if I kind of take the distance between her eyes, and I then take the distance from the chin up, it puts me right there, the spot on the bridge of the nose, right between the eyes. And that's a really handy proportion. And that's generally something that you'll see in other people as well, is that, so then the distance between the corner of the eyes, corner to corner, that distance is the same as from chin to right there, the spot right between the eyes. So that, it's not an equilateral triangle, but the base and the height are the same. Okay, so I think what I need to do now, let's get in there and we'll start to render the eyes. So this is, ideally, this is the point at which we'd be like, all right, this has a likeness of that person. And that's where I'm a little hesitant in that, because I don't feel that likeness. I feel like it looks like a person on the page, but it doesn't feel like her yet. But I'm gonna move forward with it so you can see how the rendering of the eyes comes together. Looking at kind of this double line, there's that dark, that upper eyelid generally casts a shadow. The eyelashes are a bit stronger. And then that eyelid kind of folds into another crease in there. What's really helpful is to try to keep that line soft. So I'm utilizing the side of the pencil, kind of sneaking up on that line. I'm going to have to move the eyebrows a little bit. And it's not a perfectly symmetrical form, so that upper eyelid, the height of it, the high point of it is going to be off to the left. Left side of the iris here. And then on the lower eyelid, I'm sorry, I had that right, the wrong, the high point is on the right here, on the inside of that iris. And the lower eyelid is a little bit off to the left. So it's not a perfectly round form. If you kind of break it into these straighter sections, kind of levels out a bit at the top, and then it turns down into the eye socket here, but generally the high point is over here on the inside, on the upper eyelid, on the outside, on the lower eyelid. And you can kind of see how that kind of wraps around. And I want to be careful with that lower eyelid because that's catching the light. I made her pupil and iris way too big. So she has really big eyes here. And the iris and the pupil are not centered in the eye. It kind of, the eye kind of sits a little up in the eye socket there. The lower eyelid kind of wraps around underneath it. The upper eyelid comes in kind of a bit more on top. So then the pupil is kind of right underneath that upper eyelid. Still utilizing the side of the pencil here. And I'm trying to think about this as being a three-dimensional form. So this eyeball is it's a ball. It's in shadow over here, catches the light a little bit more over here. And here's what I think what I'm going to do is, before I get any farther, I want to look for that shadow here in that eye socket. See how it transitions into that nose. I want to get the light in here because I need to make sure I focus on that transition area. Where I tend to struggle is when I jump from one eye to the other. So I've maybe finished one eye, move to the other one, and then either too far apart or they're too close together. I haven't built that transition. So I want to make sure everything's going to fit the way it's supposed to. There's kind of like a little darker spot right in here, that soft part of the eye socket. And there's this kind of triangular shadow shape here. I'm imagining right now, I'm just kind of imagining that eyebrow is gone. I'm looking at the bone structure here as it goes into that eye socket and wraps around the side of the head. We come in under here. Looking for this shape here, okay. So that's starting to come together. Gives me a little bit more definition so I can then move across. You know, this all fits together. Gets really dark in here. And that helps to create a strong focal point because we have a brightest part and the darkest part right here in the center of the portrait. Trying to sit vertically. So if I'm crossing into the shot, let me know. OBB is pointing out some proportions that are going to be that are off, and I just want to say that's welcome here. I want to have that happen. So as I go through, feel free to shout out areas that are off. Now I'm already anticipating that they're off, so I'm kind of working generally and gradually becoming more specific. So now that I have the general shape in place, I'm locking in the eyes, going to move down to the nose and then to the mouth, and then see how that works out. When I did the self-portrait one, that was really helpful to have you all there kind of pointing out some of the proportions. Now, keeping in mind, though, it's going to be hard to read them as they come through, so I may miss some of them, but I want you all to know that it's perfectly safe and acceptable to, in this environment, to offer suggestions about where things should be moved or how some of the shapes might be changed. So that's why we're drawing together, is we're here to help each other. And drawing and talking at the same time can be a challenge. I mean, drawing portraits is really hard. It's really hard, as you all know. And I have so much respect for the great portrait artists out there. It's tremendously humbling working on a portrait. But I think if we all work together, we can kind of provide, some support for each other. So start to lock that down. I'm trying to look at that specific shape of the pupil and the iris there. And then the eyelashes come in here. What I'm also combating the glare right now. So this graphite is pretty shiny. And so it's this is really kind of screwing me up here. Boy, she looks angry right now, doesn't she? let's see. And that's what I respect so much about portraiture is the how subtle it can be. What I love about working in landscapes is that it's generally forgiving, in that like I can be off with the shape of a tree and you still recognize it as a tree. You know, if I'm off with a portrait, it becomes another person, right? And so that is where it can be really challenging. And some of the great portrait artists are caricature artists. That's how Monet started, actually. And what caricature artists do, they get really good at locking in on what is unique about the portrait. And that's typically actually how we view people. What's happening neurologically when we look at a person is that our brain populates itself with kind of a general head. It's almost like our brain has an accumulation of all the people it's ever seen, and it merges it into one person that's completely average. We start with that, so our brain is already loaded, and then when we observe a person in front of us, we're kind of primed to see what kind of stands out and what makes that person kind of unique. And that's what allows our vision, our visual system, our visual sense to become efficient, is that we start to anticipate. You know, our brain fills itself with expectations. That locking into what kind of makes somebody kind of unique is really kind of exciting, and that's what makes caricature work so effective. So I'm just kind of refining the eyes now. I'm still trying to squint a bit as I go, so I don't want to get locked into details when I'm not ready, because I'm not sure I can't quite have this right yet. So all right, I think what I need to do is come back to the eye. This is not right. I know it's not right in here. So kind of going back to the idea of suggesting improvements on proportions, you know, like I said, feel free to call them out. Everybody in this community has been really respectful about that in general, so I appreciate that. I think that's part of why we're here. When I teach drawing on ground, I've taught at various community colleges and online. Developing the skill of discussing your observations is really it's really important. You know, otherwise it's easy to say, get to deliver harsh criticisms that are unhelpful, that don't really lead the artist to the point of which they can actually improve. There's a particular art in providing observations in a way that allows then the artist that you're critiquing to walk away with something concrete that they can say, all right, now that's what I need to do. And for me, what it comes down to is really understanding that it's all about providing observations. What are you seeing? And then allowing the artist to then evaluate from there, is that what is desired? Do you want that to happen? If not, then we can talk about what needs to happen, what needs to change. Let's see. So hopefully that makes sense. What I need to do is I need to get that highlight on the tip of her nose right in here to help make that feel more three-dimensional. I'm having a hard time seeing that as a three-dimensional object, and thus it's difficult to render it. Maybe what I can do, let me See if I can zoom in. Zoom a little bit more so you can see. The one, I don't want to get to that fine detail yet. Now the nose has got this really dramatic kind of W shape here. Kind of dark right in here. Building up with these short circular marks to try to find that form. Kind of going back to the feedback, one of the things that I've had viewers ask before about, you know, kind of what feedback looks like. How do you ask people for feedback, and who do you ask? And one of the things that I like to remind people is that, you know, when we ask, you know, friends and family that may not have had spent much time with drawing or art, what they think or how they feel, it can be difficult to put that into words. And it can often, people can often feel put in on the spot to provide an answer, and that answer may not be helpful. So I think it can sometimes be helpful to encourage, you know, people you're asking for feedback to provide specific feedback. You know, let's look at this one area. What do you think? You know, how does this, you know, what are you observing in here? And you also want to kind of put that in perspective. You know, there are some people whose opinions I value a bit more because they have the ability to articulate what they're observing. And, you know, it's not a situation where they say, well, the nose is wrong, right? You know, or the eyes are wrong, or whatever. It's a thing where they can add more to it, and they understand the struggle that we all go through to get to, you know, a certain point in the drawing. And so, just kind of keep that in mind. Let's see, Krisha, the jawline should be narrower, but I mean, I really feel like you're right. I need to, when I get down to that spot, so Krisha is saying the jawline might need to be narrower. That's the way it's feeling to me too. I think once I lock down the nose and the eyes, then I think I'll be able to kind of define that a little bit more. Yeah, and then Ida is also saying that her face is thinner. Yeah, and I definitely agree. Yep. Okay. Looking at the right iris should be a bit smaller. Thank you. Welcome, new people. I'm glad to see you on here. If you're joining us for the first time, I am tremendously grateful to have you join us. I'm Scott with the Artist Network, and we've been doing this series. This is episode 32, I think, 32, 33, somewhere around there. And you'll find links in the video below, or below the video, you'll find links to artistnetwork.com, where if you go to the Drawing Together resource page, I've pulled together some additional resources there. You know, we're just trying to utilize this time when so many of us are at home to improve our skills. And you can also join the community. We have on that same page, you'll find links to individual show pages where you will be able to see other people's work, post your own, and generally kind of comment. Join the group. I've seen some people sharing stuff on the Artist Network Facebook page as well, which is exciting. I'll be going tomorrow live on Facebook, on the Artist Network Facebook channel there. So one of the things that looking at the eye that can be really helpful is, you know, seeing in that upper eyelid how it's generally in shadow, but try to make it three-dimensional by pulling out a little bit of light right there at the top where it's catching it, and then kind of rounding into that shadow in the inner side of the socket. And we're seeing that over here as well. And As I come down in here, let's see, I'm going to come back, I think, and really kind of sharpen that up a little bit more. I want to kind of define this a little bit. So as I'm working on that lower eyelid, it's a little bit darker on the inside, so I'm going to work my way out and try to observe where along that sphere of the eyeball it starts to transition into that light. This is just my kneaded eraser. I can tap up some areas to bring in some light. There's light catching that upper part of the eye socket here. And again, I've kind of gotten rid of the eyebrows for now, just trying to see the shape of that brow, and then I can come back in and add the eyebrows later. Let's see. I'm having trouble with this glare. I'm gonna look up here, see what I think. Let's see. Yeah, her face is too big here. So what I think I need to do, thank you all for pointing that out. Sorry, I'm kind of lost in calculation right now, where I'm trying to think more specifically about some of these proportions, because I know this feels too big, and what I want to make sure it's a specific decision, that I'm making a declarative statement that I know where it should go. I think this is it. Kind of starting up here at the top, and I'm working my way in. And if you're new to the series, you may not have heard me say this. If you have been around, you will have heard me say that you're always contributing to the form. So here I have my eraser, but I'm not just removing stuff. I'm trying to contribute to the form. And when I'm shading, again, I'm trying to contribute to the form. So this is what, you can see that I'm kind of leaning over like this. I keep finding myself doing that. That's throwing off my proportions. As I come across here, now I'm more in line with the portrait, and I can see more clearly where I'm off. So that should help a bit. I kind of put myself in a tight spot there because I was kind of squaring up. I wasn't squaring up with the portrait. All right, I think it looks like I need to zoom back out a little bit so you can see what's happening down in here. Again, move your eyes always back and forth. I'm gonna work my way into the mouth area, I think. Let's see, I'm feeling pretty good about those proportions there. Then, kind of lock that jaw down right in here. Here it gets a little bit difficult to see. Sorry. Excellent. I love seeing all these comments here. If you're drawing along and you're stuck on something, you know, feel free to throw that out to the group. See if we have any suggestions on what can happen. You know, it's hard to share specifically, you know, without being able to see the work, but all right, I'm just going to kind of suggest the form of the ear. Again, I'm just going to kind of let the rest of the head be sketchy. Now, this is where I tend to always struggle. So I need to really evaluate corner of the mouth and that distance from the nose. And I feel like this needs to come up perhaps just a little bit. I'm going to look for the general shape of that upper lip. We're seeing how that's in shadow. I'm not going to worry about that central line right now. And then what we notice about that lower lip is that, you know, there's a little bit of light kind of catching on and over in this area here. But, you know, see how soft that is right in there. It's not a hard line to define the lips, and we have a tendency to want to draw those lines for the lips, but we want to see how that lower lip kind of rolls and it catches the light here, falls into shadow here, and then it casts a shadow underneath here. So really look for that form. Let's see, does that, that feels a bit right. Like I said, as I said earlier, I have a feeling that this is going to come out looking like a person, but maybe not like this person. So I just see it going that way. And but I'm going to keep going. Okay. Now sneaking up on that form, I want this to be soft here around the corner of the lips. So you see how I didn't draw the outline for the lips. I'm trying to draw that as a shape so that it feels integrated with the rest of the head. I think what I need to do is get this locked down here, that upper lip. Look for that kind of triangle of light here. Yeah, there's something is not just feeling too heavy, but we're gonna keep going. Just keep going and adjusting as we go. So I'm trying to now as I'm making observations about what feels off. Sometimes at this point it's so subtle. If I don't know what is off and how to fix it, I'm just gonna kind of leave it. So that I'm not just kind of moving things around without having a kind of a game plan. Yeah, Nihai, they got definitely a sharper line on the jaw we're going to need. I want to try to feel more confident in these primary features and then work out to that jaw line. I think adding the eyebrows is going to make a big difference too. Make that a, let's see if I can make her lips a bit more delicate in there. Just see soft circular marks here in the center because I don't want that to be a hard line. This is all in shadow. I think I need to now use this eraser doing some negative drawing to kind of refine that jawline, but I need to merge that with the neck. Let's see. Something like that. Let's see how that works. And if you are new, you'll have seen people are posting in all caps. And that helps me to see observations and comments a bit more easily. I see a comment about the lips being more pursed, and I think I do need to kind of, now that I've kind of generally placed them, I need to start to refine those forms a bit. So just using the kneaded eraser very gently. Then figure out how detailed, and then what happens here is that there's a little bit of light right there in that, right in the corner of the mouth that's catching that lower lip, and that's an interesting kind of expression that if I can get that off, it's kind of leaving a mark that's not coming off. Oh well. So there's a mark that's a bit more permanent than I'd like it to be. There we go. I'm just kind of working on that lip back and forth between using the eraser and using the shading stump. Till I get something that feels right. So one of the things I recently did a drawing that kind of focuses more on the nose and the lips. And one of the things we talked about is really observing how the upper and the lower lips kind of lock into one another. So when we're looking at the shape of the mouth line there, really seeing how at the front, it's almost like a tiny little beak that comes in on top of that lower lip. And then as we move around back here, that lower lip starts to come out on top. And then that upper lip kind of comes in on top of that as it wraps around on top of the lower lip. Let's see, I think that starts to define it a little bit more. It's got a bit of a scowl. Let's see, all right. Need to darken this right in here a little bit more. That lower lip is casting a shadow a bit more. Really fading it out on the ends. And then we see light catching under here. So appreciate all the feedback here. I think I'm missing a bunch of comments here, sorry. But again, if you have any kind of comments, questions, see people, some people are just making random things for some reason, but welcome to join us if you have something to contribute. All right, so let's see. I'm gonna stay on this side here. I'm gonna come around to the lip. So what I'm doing right here is I'm actually thinking about this part of the drawing. I'm not quite sure. I don't have my head really kind of wrapped around it. So while I'm thinking about that, I'm doing something down here that requires less thinking. I'm just kind of shading in that neck right here and towards the center there. Because I need to better understand that form. This is kind of locked down, so I can start to shade this a little bit more, maybe define it a bit more. Such a tricky line to see there, that it's the series of compound curves along the jaw. You know, there's a general angle to it, but then within it, you can break it apart into these very specific curves that can be tricky to see. Her jaw just feels too big, too heavy right now. And I need to understand why that is. Let's see. Bring that in a little bit. Maybe I just need to come in a little bit more. Maybe bring out the chin a little bit more here too. I mean, that feels a little bit better, but okay. So again, I'm doing all this work, but it's all setting up this this part of the drawing right over here. Let's see. So if I take this distance, I'm looking at the width of the mouth, and I'm comparing that to the distance from the distance between these two corners, the distance from the corner to the edge there. And I need to kind of evaluate that. So I'm going to use my pencil. This is called comparative measuring. And if I take this and what I've observed, if I carry this distance across, then that jawline should actually be intersecting somewhere right around in here. Some angle setting, so I think I did draw her head too wide, significantly wider than it needed to be. And it's really interesting to observe how that is consistent in my drawing. You know, I do that a lot, and I correct in a consistent manner. And I think I mentioned this in one of the previous drawings as well. If there's this great documentary on Leonardo painting, drawing, kind of mixed media piece ultimately, that is trying to be, they're trying to authenticate it in this documentary. And one of the things they do is they bring in a master artist to do a master copy. And then the objective in a master copy isn't to walk away with a facsimile of the original. It's not just to say, all right, now I have something that looks like the original. The real power in a master copy is that you put yourself in the mind of the artist and you try to follow along step by step, mark by mark, as much as you can the original. It's like you take time to really sit with it and try to observe what marks came first, what comes next. Is it a hard mark, soft mark, quick? Is it confident? Is it subtle? Is it, you know, heavy, bold, etc.? You look at all of those things, and then you put yourself in the mind of the artist, and you try to reverse engineer it to walk away with something similar to that. So that's what happens in this documentary. And one of the things that this artist observed is she said that that you can see in that drawing, in this Leonardo, there are fine areas where mistakes were being corrected. And those mistakes are consistent with other Leonardo drawings. It's something that he did regularly. And I find that really fascinating. And I think that's something that we all do, is that we all tend to err in the same direction multiple times. So I'm kind of going to invent a kind of a shoulder for her. It's not in the reference, but I'm going to try to invent one that feels, you know, somewhat believable, so that there's some sort of kind of anchoring to the bottom of the page. So just some kind of quick marks there. But I'm feeling like that's a bit more, again, it doesn't look like her, but it has starting to have more of that delicacy. It's really fascinating. Okay. I need to come back into the eyes as well and finish these up. Her eyes are off. There's kind of the wrong angle to them. I feel better about this one over here. And maybe what I need to do is get these eyebrows in place. Yeah, here we go. Trying to observe again how that eyebrow wraps up and over the bone of the brow. Doing some angle sighting, and that's not the right angle. Do the same over here. So looking at some of these orientation points, checking some of these angles. I need to see it in front of me here. Hannah, yes, I think you're talking about the cheekbones being more prominent in the photos. I definitely think you're right there. That's a good observation. Let's see how this does. Does this actually do something? One of the things that you also want to observe is the eyebrows, how they, you know, they are affected by light and shadow as well. So she has relatively dark eyebrows, but they're going to be darker where it falls into shadow, and they're catching the light in some other areas as well. So, okay, let me think here. This eye is not right here. Sorry, I'm just kind of focusing a bit here, so I'm not talking a whole lot, but I'm going to keep checking. I see a comment about one eye being bigger than the other. That's exactly what I was observing as well, and I need to kind of reconcile that a bit more and figure out what is there. I've kind of let them slip on their axis as well. The pupil is too large. And so then the question is how long are we at right now? We're at an hour and a quarter. Okay, that's not as bad as I thought it would be. We're a bit farther along than I thought we'd be. This is going to be a little while. We're going to keep going until I get this thing fixed, I think, or getting it a little bit closer at least. The expression in her eye is not quite right either. And then this, I feel like her iris pupil. Well, that looks creepy. Okay, now I'm going to kind of shrink that up a little bit. Try to, what I'm doing right now is I'm trying to observe the shape of the whites. And that might help to correct some of those things. So I think I need to do that here as well. Just kind of a light drawing with the eraser here. Doing some negative drawing. So looking at the shape of the whites. I have a drawing, early on in the series I did a drawing of just my eye. So if you are all interested in kind of just drawing an eye, you might check out that that episode. Does that feel any better? And this is kind of a good example too of why it's important to kind of step away from your work. You know, you all help provide an additional context to it. You're seeing it with a different set of eyes and bringing those observations to me, so then I can see it in a fresh way. Without that, if it's just you working, I think one of the most helpful tools you can do is just give it some time. Come back to it a bit later. Let me see here. I think this upper eyelid needs to come up a little bit more. And as you notice, I haven't used the sharp point of my pencil yet. I'm still utilizing the kind of the blunt side because I got to move things around still. There's a lot of adjustment. I'm not confident in this. And this comes down in here. I think what I need to do is see this form a little bit more. So I'm erasing a little bit here in that shadow area. I think this is where I can start to define those cheekbones a little bit more. So maybe if I shift to that, as was suggested, this doesn't seem right. Okay. If I'm looking at that corner of the eye, I'm measuring down across here. I feel like I allowed that nose to maybe migrate a little bit more. Something seems off with the nose. Pick up some of that charcoal here and reestablish that shadow. Maybe kind of pull out a little bit of that highlight. There's not a light highlight, but there's a little bit of bounce light right in here on that cheekbone. Okay, so now that kind of comes around and makes kind of a relatively sharp turn right into that shadow, kind of falls into that shadow. Come up here and there's that shadow here on the bottom side of the nose. Maybe make her nose a bit sharper right in here. Okay, what are we doing here? Let's see. Sorry, I'm kind of focused right now, so I don't know if there's any comments coming in that could help with the proportions. But again, if you're watching this and you see something that could be adjusted, feel free to shout that out. just kind of working back and forth between with the eraser and the charcoal. That's too sharp, so. Whoa. That shading stump really deposited a fair amount on there. So I'm gonna lighten that back up again. There's a little bit of a light here. So generally the light catches on a turn, so it's generally brighter right in here on the inside of that bridge of the nose, kind of comes down along the ridge. Then right at the tip of the nose, we see a highlight as well. Let's come across here. I'm gonna try to sculpt a little bit with the eraser. So I'm just looking at areas where the light might be stronger because it's catching the structure of the face a bit more. It's got these hairs here. I'm gonna try to suggest those. Yeah, this doesn't seem like it's quite capturing the likeness the way I had hoped, but it's a fun challenge. And it just doesn't feel like her, you know, what I'm seeing from the reference photo. That's what makes self-portraits so challenging as well. We have such a familiarity with them. We're used to seeing ourselves so much that... you know, it just becomes really kind of challenging to get that right. We become very critical of it. So I feel like her eyes are perhaps too small. Let's see. But here's what I think I'm going to do. Since I don't know what's wrong, I'm going to move over to something else. I'm going to start to just kind of lightly sketch in the rest of the hair. So I'm going to be looking for the shapes of the light and dark. There's no solid, you know, strong line along the hairline. I'm just trying to react to the flow of the hair and provide it just enough context so it doesn't become too distracting from the rest of the portrait. And then here in the photo, it becomes very difficult to see what's happening. So I'm not going to try to invent too much. I want to let that edge be... it'd be kind of just subtle and fugitive. But hopefully this has given you some suggestions on how to approach your own portrait. Hopefully you're being kind to yourself if you're struggling. Like I said, I'm struggling too. That's why we're here, is this is all about practicing and improving. I mean, it'd be awesome if I really nailed this. That would feel great, but it's not. You know, I'm happy with it. Like I said, I feel like this looks like a person. So now I want to see what I can do to make it feel like that person. So let me just get enough of the... enough of that suggestion here. That'll help to create that three-dimensional quality of the head. There's like these kind of finer lines right in here. That seems too high. Let me see. Bring that down. Let's see. But hopefully that gives a little bit more suggestion. You can see I'm not putting much detail or emphasis on this. I want to get that general shape. See if we can get the rest of the portrait working. It's got these strands coming down and over here. A light kind of coming in on here on the top of the head. All right, let's see if that's just kind of enough to suggest that. I think this, so Hannah is asking the space between the bottom lip and her chin, nose, thinking it's the space in here, that could definitely be it. The nose and lips, it makes her look like she's looking straight ahead, unlike the photo, yes. Yes. Kind of generally in the area, but it's not quite there. Let's see, if I go like this, what happens? So if I do some angle sighting, corner of the nostril to the corner of the mouth, and you can see they're not lining up. And now this one here, that's generally a bit better. If I do a plumb line through her eye, that corner of the mouth kind of aligns with this. So I've got it generally right. Huh, okay. Newbie question, the way you're holding the pencil is pretty cool. Can you explain on that a little bit? Okay, the way I'm holding the pencil, there's a couple ways to hold a pencil. This is a tripod grip, which is the way we hold it when we write. So we gives us a lot of fine control and is meant for, creating these small fine marks. I like to use this overhand grip. So basically, if you put the pencil down on the table and you just grip it with your fingertips, you can work like that. I'm putting the pressure down with my index finger, and it gives me just a greater range of motion when I'm drawing, so I'm using my arm a bit more. The other way I like to draw is I like to hold it like this. And so I'm just wedging it between my fingers here, almost like chopsticks. And so I can use my thumb to apply the pressure, and I can engage the side of the pencil a bit more, and I can just come in, I can rotate my hand to add a little bit of detail if I need to, without having to change my grip. So you'll see me kind of switch between an overhand and then whatever this is, grip here, where I'm just kind of holding it more like a set of chopsticks. The left eye pupil is off. Yeah, I think I need to come back. I want to, I feel like the size of the eyes might be a bit off. I think one of the things I didn't do is this isn't really the sight size method. This isn't a one-to-one scale drawing, and that might be making it difficult for me. I want to see the shadows a bit more clearly in here. That might help to drop those into shadow a bit more. And then come into it. I know there's something off in this. Hannah said that, pointed that out earlier, and I think you're really onto something there. I think you're correct that something is off in here. So let's try to correct it a little bit. I don't want to take up too much of your time, and I should be going pretty soon, but I want to see if I can try to correct this as much as possible. And this is one of the challenges to working at an angle like this. When I see it vertically, I can see things that are off. And left jaw line is off. Yes, exactly. Something is definitely wrong in here. Something's wrong in here as well. But what I was doing is that, so if you remember a few minutes ago, 15 minutes or so ago, I placed that jawline relative to the corner of this mouth. What I didn't do was double check to make sure that the corner of the mouth was correct. So that is entirely where it could be off. And then I think what I need to do actually is I'm going to use this eye as a way to gauge that placement of the mouth. I'm going to use some angle sighting. So if I take this angle here, so I'm going to line it with the edge of the the nostril there, right to the corner of the mouth, get that angle. And that would suggest that corner needs of the mouth needs to be up here. So maybe that mouth needs to move up there. And if I do that, then this jawline needs to move in accordance with that. So it's all a big network. Everything is connected. And there is a kind of a slight downturn to her mouth, and I think I had it going the opposite direction more. It's got to be a slight downturn there. And then Betty is saying a highlight to her lower jaw. Yeah, like right in here, there's a little bounce light in there. I don't know if that's what you're looking at, but I need to. And then there's also the light striking here. So I think a lot of it has to happen in that lower portion. That doesn't seem right. So what I did is I placed that corner, I readjusted it based on the nostril there. Now I need to double check, is that nostril correct? Is there anything off there? And I kind of feel like there is. I feel like this needs to move a little bit over here because she does have a slight turn to her head. Let me see here. And then I can take that line, and I think that might need to come up just a little bit more here. So if I do that, if I roughen the lips now, how does that work? Let's see. Now she's got two set of lips here, so. That brings us up, and I think it does give a little bit more room to her chin. So now we got this mess of a space over here in these lips, so I need to start to refine that a little bit more. Shorter between nose and top lip. Yes. Yeah, and I think that's just what I just corrected in here. I think should do that. I'm gonna soften that. Work with the shading stump here. And this is still off, so I'm gonna come back over here and adjust this in a bit. I'm looking for the asymmetrical form of her lips. So they're generally symmetrical, but it's the asymmetry that's gonna create that slight turn so that the left and the right sides aren't quite identical. Now that shadow under the lip is too big because I've got two of them on top of one another now. So just using that kneaded eraser. And let's see, her lower lip kind of right in here. And I want to go in and draw that center line of the mouth a little bit. But I want to get that, maybe try to get that light. Is that feeling any better? Let's see. I'm asking you and I'm asking me, is that feeling any better? Let me go back in here. Redraw that line. So now I've drawn her mouth how many times? Several times now. Now it's really crooked. we're going to get there. Kind of need to draw from the, thank you, somebody says this looks so bad. That is a very helpful comment. So, let's see, bring this up a little bit. That distance feels a little bit better now, so I'm gonna make some adjustments. I want to thank you all for providing some feedback here. feels like we're drawing together when we do that. So I appreciate the comments, and I feel like the drawing is getting better. It still, holy smokes, just doesn't look like her. But we'll see. She looks so angry. Let's see here. Gonna continue to try to refine that. Bring this down here. The mouth is just not coming together the way I'd like it to. Okay, let me see if I can do this. This, that something in here doesn't feel quite right here. We can see, like, at this point, you know, we started off the drawing very differently. You know, very kind of just soft, kind of blocking in the basic proportions. Now things are starting to, starting to come together. But, you know, there's just a continual adjustment that needs to happen. And I think it's worth it to kind of take that time. You know, as I said, when I pulled out that earlier version that I started with, the one I did yesterday, you know, it's one thing to make a drawing that looks like a person, and it's another thing to make it look like that person. And like I said, this doesn't look like this person at this point. But there's still value in this whole exercise. And let me see. So I'm feeling, how do I feel about this? This, I feel like her nose is off. Doesn't look like her nose. But I mean, hopefully this gives you a sense of kind of the drawing process as something that is always emerging and evolving on the page. The idea that it's all, you know, a linear process, I think can be destructive for in some way. It's, you know, you're for me, it a drawing expresses the whole process. It's a record of this time and together. And so I think drawings become more exciting to me when they start to express that struggle. I love the sketches that we see of Michelangelo, for example, and with David. We can see some of the preparatory sketches and or other sculptures that he's got, and you can see how they're thinking through things. To me, that becomes really exciting in drawing, and so hopefully that you guys kind of embrace that part of it as well. All right, I think now I need to get back into the eyes. I think her mouth just feels too, something's really off here, but it's all about the, the eyes I think definitely capture it. You know, there's all the sayings that, you know, the eyes are the window of the soul, etc. You know, it's all about capturing the eyes. To me, a lot of it comes down to getting the proportions right. And that's where I must be off somewhere, because I've gotten myself into the weeds here, where I've lost sight of the overall proportion. So now I made determinations about the width of the mouth without checking them against the eyes, right? And so are they placed in proportion with the eyes correctly? And those are some of the things that can start to deviate. Throughout the process, you got to be continually checking. What happens is, like, there's always this instinct to want it to be right and jump to that correct form. And sometimes it's just not there. Sometimes you just got to power through it. So maybe that's what I'll do here, is kind of continue to power through it. I got just not so saw something on the shape of the nose that I want to understand. Okay, so here's what I want to do. Let me, what I'm doing now is, instead of going for the eyes, I'm trying to address the negative space, the space around the eyes. So I'm building up from the nose into the eye socket, that lower eyelid. And I want to trust that that's going to help me create that eye. Because what I've got here is something that approximates, it looks like an eye, of course, but it doesn't look like hers. And if I'm going to do that on this side, I want to do that on the other side as well, kind of carry that across, thinking through the structure here. Thinking through that angle here. Kind of knock that down a little bit. I'm kind of lost some of that form in here, but I'll come back to that. All right. So now that the challenge is that I've got the old drawing, I've got the incorrect eyes, and I'm trying to get the correct eyes on top. So right now she looks pissed, right? It doesn't look good at all. So I need to kind of try to stay clear in my head about what I'm drawing and not get caught up in the expression that she's got right now, because I know it's incorrect, right? So let's see. But I want to continue that thought process of working in that negative space. I want to try to find the structure of the eye in here. So seeing that eye socket, and I'm squinting to try to see the shape of this shadow here, coming across here to see this shadow. Okay, so I'm doing some angle sighting from the corner of the mouth to the corner of the eyes, and that's feeling better. Corner of the mouth to corner of the eyes, and a little bit better looking, but not actually really the eyes, but looking at the shape of the eye socket, so shadows there. Got to clear my head a little bit, so I'm just going to smudge this out, move on to something else here for a little bit. And work back and forth between them. And I've lost the jawline a bit. All right, let's see. I think the outer corner of the eye could be turned a little up. Yeah. Seeing, just reading some of the comments here. Thank you all for continuing to provide feedback. That's why we're drawing together. And it's not just draw like me. I mean, I think to me, what gets really exciting about drawing is to see the individual character of who you are as an artist come through in the drawing. You can't really avoid it. Your eyebrows are going to need to come up as a result. But you all have your, there's something in your, in the touch that you've got on the, of your pencil that is unique to you, and I love seeing that. And the ways that your drawing is going to be off are going to be different than the ways that this drawing is off, and that's going to be unique to you. It says something about how you observe people, and that may be something that you want to incorporate into your own portraiture work if you're, you know, if you're really into portrait art, portraiture as an artist. Like I said, I would recommend, you know, really taking a class with somebody who's dedicated themselves to portraiture. Oh, that's not right there. they can give you perhaps more precise feedback. The feedback that you need might be a bit more effective. But I've said it before in this, is that when you find that person that gives you the feedback that is really useful to you, it's a very valuable thing. So be mindful of who you're going to, and their observations, kind of take it all in, find what works for you. Let's see here. Just doesn't look quite as odd. I feel like it's starting to come together, but it's still off. But hopefully this is enough of a lesson to give you something to really focus on here. So, all right. So I'm looking in now in this shape here. I've got the old eyes and the new ones need to be forming in here. So I'm looking at that dark shape underneath that lower eyelid. I'm going to use this kneaded eraser to kind of pull out some of that light that I'm going to cut back into. And now I'm going to redraw the pupil and the iris, looking at the negative shape, the shape of the white. How much of the white can I actually see? And as many of you stated, I drew it too large. So I can come in a little bit more. The high point in the eye here. And I try to continually check my proportions. Where am I in the right spot? I'm just kind of adding, now I'm adding that upper eyelid. It's not just a hard line. There's, it's a fold in there. It's a little bit better. So it's a little bit darker here in the corner. Get a little bit of a highlight on that upper eyelid right in here. A light catches up here. And I need to move that eyebrow up there a little bit. So hopefully this is coming together a little bit better. The forehead is too narrow compared to the width of the jaw. She has a triangular, yeah. And it's a good observation as well. I need to come back into that. I want to adjust that, the eyebrows though, because I know they need to come up a little bit now that I'm reworking the eyes. Again, I'm not feeling like this looks like her. Sorry, I got to cut into the shot here. Because there's, what I need to do is bring this down. I've lost the angle of the eyes. They're kind of angling down too much. And so I'm kind of reworking those, and then as I feel more confident in the eyes, then I kind of address the forehead a bit more. Okay, and then there, this eye here, there is a noticeable angle that I didn't really account for each eye. I'd given that a horizontal axis across here to keep the eyes from shifting up and down. But what that did is it actually locked me in. I was focusing so much on that horizontal axis to make sure that they were in line that I locked the corners of the eyes onto that axis. And the reality is that there's a slight angle because those eyes are wrapping around there. So that's what I'm observing right now and coming in, being able to get my head into the shot and look directly down at it allowed me to see that, because back here it looks better. I see that angle, but it's when I come in and I'm looking directly at it, that's when I really start to notice that. So it's just something to consider, you know, if you're working on that flat surface, tilt it up to make sure that you are, that things are looking good and that you're not compensating for the perspective. It's something that's very natural to do. Sorry, I see some comments coming in and I'm missing them. So I'm gonna try to do my best to go back and view them. But so now what I've done is I've worked this eye so much. Look at it, it's not coming up at all. Let me move that pupil. So her pupil and iris are too big. Maybe I'll have her look off that one side a little bit more. So the eye, this is incorrect, but I've kind of worked myself into a corner there. I can't erase back down. It's just not gonna happen. Okay, so I need to come across here. Make sure that the eyes stay in alignment. Place that inner portion of the eye socket. I need to pull out some a little too light, too dark in there. And then, yeah, her eyes have an angle if we go from corner to corner. And that's what I was missing as I was compensating for the perspective looking at it at this angle. I completely missed that entirely. So, now this is something too that I'm kind of sticking with this a bit longer than I wanted to or anticipated. When I did the self-portrait, I heard from several of you that you would have benefited from me kind of working through the corrections a bit more. So that's kind of what I'm doing now as well. Is I'm going to try to stick with it a bit more to see if there's any kind of learning that can come out of it that you might be able to take away as well. And where I'm seeing that all of these are off. I'm just looking for that shape. Hopefully that feels a little bit better, but it's hard to... made such a mess out of this paper now. It's hard to really see what I've got. Her eye looks all kind of messy right now, so let me try to clean that up. Come back in here. Doing some kind of negative drawing by drawing that lower eyelid. And so kind of going back to what I was saying earlier about proportions, I feel like getting the proportions is really essential. I think we get really sensitive to the unique proportions of an individual. Just like, you know, facial recognition software is really built on measuring the scale of the features and the space between the features. And I feel like that we kind of have that same kind of mechanism in a way, where there's so much that's carried about a person that's carried in the proportions, the spaces between things. What did I do there? Let's see. I guess that's all right. So I feel like getting those proportions is really essential for creating a likeness. You know, and then there are areas like the eyes where getting the eyes right is really important as well. But I find that if you get the proportions right, you can be off a bit in the details, and it still creates that person. Whereas Whereas, you know, the opposite, you may get the eyes just right, but you get those proportions incorrect, it could really throw things off. May not be recognizable as that person. So that's just my take on it. I've got so much graphite built up on here. I got this sheen that makes it difficult to see. I need to check the cameras because that may be impacting things as well. I get those eyebrows in there too. I want to get this structure established. So thank you all for sticking around this long. It's a bit longer than I knew this was going to be a long one, but a bit longer than I anticipated. But I'm glad that we can sit here and correct some of these errors. See if we can continue to push that, and hopefully it shows that, you know, how malleable a drawing can be. This eye needs to come in a little bit more this way. You know, it's kind of you can make a lot of adjustments throughout the whole process. One of the things I've seen students struggle with in the past is, kind of getting locked into something. That's what's happened here. I got locked into something and things are off. What I like to encourage students to do is think of a drawing as though you're drawing in sand. Let me push this up there here. Think about it as though you're drawing in sand. All these marks can move around on the page. Let me kind of adjust the shape of the forehead a little bit. This needs to come out like that. But hopefully we're getting a little bit closer. Let me see. And let's see, mouth and jaw seem different. Yeah, there's so much that needs to be adjusted. It's funny how, like, these aren't major differences that we're seeing between the drawing and the reference photo, but it's in those subtleties where everything kind of comes together. Right now I'm just looking up at the drawing here, kind of checking the comments a bit. Let me get her eyebrows in. I think that would be helpful. I appreciate all the encouragement that you're all offering, and I hope that you're all drawing along as well. So again, if you're kind of joining us late, you'll find the reference photo in the description below. You also find resources for drawing in that Drawing Together page on artistnetwork.com. I'm going to be back here on YouTube live. I'm going to be drawing a dog on Wednesday at 3 p.m. Eastern. So we meet every Monday, Wednesday, 3 p.m. Eastern here on YouTube. And I'm doing a special one tomorrow. I'm going to be doing another rose drawing on our Facebook channel. So you can, if you want to get a kind of a sense for what that's going to be like, I have the other another rose drawing up on the YouTube channel here. I did one. It's a slightly different colored rose. I'll be working in charcoal rather than graphite like I am here. That's going to be tomorrow at noon Eastern time. I'm here out here in Colorado. So it'll be 10 o'clock my time out here. Let's see. Erase this out here, see what happens. see if I can adjust that jawline a little bit. So what I want to do is find that dark turn on the curve, right? And that's kind of right in line over here. Really move that around throughout the drawing today. I can see all my old marks. I think I talked about one of the artists that really got to me when I was starting out was Frank Auerbach, who would do these wonderful charcoal drawings, and it would be so, you would just get into it. You can feel the energy in those marks, and you get to the point where, you know, the paper would just wear down, and you know, you just slap another piece of paper on either on top of it or behind it, just keep going and going and going, and never gave up. And I love that. They're very abstract, but it took on a really interesting life to see all those corrections on there. So let's see, I think that works a little bit better. I'm feeling better about this. Yeah, it still doesn't look quite like her, but I feel like it looks like a healthier attempt than what I had on earlier. Ooh, JC, I'm not unhappy with mine, although I made her about 30 years older. Yeah. I can't wait to see it. Hopefully you post it on the Drawing Together page. And hopefully this gives you an idea that, you know, it's a struggle. Drawing is about, it's about pulling out, it's about pulling together, it's about drawing is about pulling things in, and this will, it takes time, it takes effort to make it happen. And the more you do something, of course, you're building up greater muscle memory, it becomes easier the next go around. But I love the idea, and I've talked about this before, the idea of the ugly duckling stage that every drawing tends to go through, where you feel like it's just going to fall apart at any moment. And it happens in my painting as well. And sometimes it just doesn't come together. And sometimes you fight and you fight for it, and you keep working on it, and it does come together. And that is a tremendous experience. And I encourage you to kind of, you know, stick with it. Keep going. If you struggle with that, you know, try to force yourself, you know, like to, if you say you have a drawing and it's really just falling apart, and you say, it doesn't look like this person, I'm just going to give up. Keep going. You know, right off the bat, it's never going to look like that person. You can say, give in and say, it's not going to work. Let that be your playground to explore drawing even further. You know, you start experimenting with marks, play around with proportions and adjusting and correcting, because you can come up with some really fascinating discoveries that way about how the materials work. And so sometimes you might lose the drawing in one sense. You might say, that's not what I intended, but there can be tremendous learning opportunities that come out of it. And so sometimes just forcing yourself to stay with it can be helpful. So I'm just kind of roughing in some additional marks here to help create that another the rest of the human a bit more. Yeah, I'm still off. There's still something off in that jawline. And it's so funny, when I look at it here, I feel so much better about it. And I look it up on the screen and I'm like, no, it's not right. So let me see. I'm going to stick with it. I feel like you all are hanging out with me anymore. If you have any other additional observations, Ella, I've only been drawing for about 3 weeks. Proportions are all off, but I'm glad it looks like a face. Mine definitely doesn't look like her. Yeah, it's good to hear that I'm not the only one here. So I think if you make it look like a person, you're in good shape. There we go. So Let's see what happens if I do that. Take another stab at it. Does that feel more like her? You look at it up there. It does feel a little bit better. I mean, there's something in the, I think it, there's also potentially the, something in the graphite that itself that makes it hard because, you know, there's, when I look on the digital image, like those really nice shadows in her eyes that I'm losing here, they just don't have that depth that I see in the photo. And I wonder if that's partly just the graphite. So anybody, if you're working in charcoal, I'm wondering if that's helpful to you at all. See here, and then I think that I kind of neglected her forehead kind of entirely here. So I'm just looking for some of that shape there. And then there, you know, there's also the issue of time when drawing, right? You know, we've been here together for, I don't know, what is the runtime now? Or we've got to be, are we up to 2 hours? Holy smokes. Thank you all for sticking around. You've been around this long. So if you are joining us late, you'll be able to see the whole drawing in all of its glorious failures throughout this adventure. We're trying to pull something together that looks more like the photo, but it's, yeah, there's something that's just not working right, and I may just have to sit with it a little bit longer. I can't believe we've been here for 2 hours, so I appreciate you all sticking around. That time really flew by quickly, but I'm feeling better about this. I feel like there's a lot of good drawing that just came in. Drawing that came together. I'm watching these comments that are coming up, so I'm not sure what's going on. See some people that like to use this as an opportunity to make their presence known. But I really appreciate all the contributing comments that you've had. They're all spot on. I mean, really, every comment that you all posted about the proportions, I feel like was really... really valuable, and it made a lot of sense. So I thank you all for that. I'm going to continue to make some little adjustments here, but I think I'm going to sign off and give you all a break. Join me again Wednesday, 3 p.m. Eastern, here on the same channel. I will be on Facebook Live tomorrow. So join there. See how that works. Go to Artist Network Facebook page. And I'd love to see you there. And that'll be at noon Eastern time. Not doing another portrait. I don't know if I can handle that again. So this has been brutal, if I'm honest. Just because it's so hard for me to make this work. But I'm glad that we all can enjoy this time together. And we'll get better at it. You know, I think that's the thing. If I'm going to get better at portraits, I need to draw portraits more. Every now and then I'll try to paint a portrait, and that is another learning experience. And so, it is what it is. So I appreciate it. I'm going to sign off, I think, see if there's any additional comments here, but I really appreciate it. Thank you all again for joining. It has been a blast, as always. Thank you for the encouragement, all the kind words, and the help. I can't wait to see your drawings. Just go to artistnetwork.com, post them there, and I will see you again next time. Thank you.